Identity and access management. Oracle Cloud Infrastructure Identity and Access Management lets you control who has access to your cloud resources. You'll also be able to control what type of access your group of users have and to which specific resources.
In order to start managing your infrastructure environment, you're going to need to open the navigation menu, go ahead to Identity and Security, then select the Identity tab. Before we begin, it is worth mentioning here that Oracle is using the least privilege principle in terms of security, meaning that if you just create a user, that user will not have access over any of your resources until you specifically assign the user to a group. And that group has a policy attached to it that will tell exactly what type of access and where that access should be. The best practices here would be to start by creating a compartment. A compartment is a collection of resources which will help in terms of segregating and organizing your resources for specific projects or departments or specific teams. And you're going to see here the root compartment by default, which will have the name of the cloud account, the name that you created, that you choose when you created the cloud account. And you're also going to see the managed compartment for PaaS. This will be a specific compartment created for the platform services. Those two are by default. And when you create compartment, you're going to see those two as the available options for the parent compartment. I recommend choosing a name. Well, those are actually mandatory fields. You will need to choose a name and a description. Then please choose the parent compartment. I do not recommend to provision and create any resources directly onto the root compartment. It is better to have a specific compartment in order to isolate them. We create this compartment, then we go ahead to groups. And here we create a specific group for our networking admins. We also give it a description, and that's it. That's all you need to do in order to create a group. Now we have the compartment created, we have the group created. Now, in order to bind them, we need to create a policy, which will do that by going on policies and clicking on create policy. Again, we need to give it a name and a description. Then we need to choose a compartment for the location of the policy, where the location will be stored. I recommend choosing here the root compartment because it will be easier for you later on to search and find the policies that you created, as well as maybe later on you decide to give access to a specific compartment over another sub-compartment that you have under the root, which may not have been selected in the beginning, and that may become troublesome. So the root compartment, it would be the best way here. Then you have this awesome policy builder where you have a lot of policy templates to choose from. We can search here something, a policy for the networking department. Let's see if we can find anything. And yes, we do. We have the network admins that are able to manage a cloud network. This is perfect for this scenario. And we're gonna choose our networking group that we created and as well the networking compartment. All right, and there we are gonna have the policy statements here. This is exactly how the policy looks like. You can imagine that by default you have deny all. And whenever you create a policy, you allow the group to do a specific thing, right? You also have the option, if you don't have the luck to find any of your desired policies here, desired permissions, you always have the option to click on Show Manual Editor and create your own policy. You have an example here on how the policy is constructed. And by clicking on any of the hyperlinks, it will get you to the documentation for the specific terms. right? In order to maybe restrict access to a specific region, you're gonna need the condition. You can also create multiple policies at a time by just entering a new line and going ahead and allowing another group or the same group to a different set of rules. All right, after we create the policy, all that is left is to create the user. And of course, assign it to the networking admins group. So we go ahead and we click on create user in the users tab. Here you're gonna see two options. You're gonna have the Oracle Identity Cloud Services, which is our default identity provider. This will be your federated identity if you choose to create the username with. Then you also have the option to use a local identity or the identity and access management user. If we choose this, and for this example, we're gonna go with this one, we're just gonna give it a name and a description. So for example, we're gonna have network admin, and again, we're gonna choose demo as the description. The email is optional here, as opposed to do federated one where the email is a mandatory field. Okay, after we created our network admin group, we just need to go ahead on the user's page and add the user to the networking admins group. Okay, we already added the user to the group by clicking on this blue button here. After we did this, the user will leverage all the permissions, all the policies that the network admins has. And by doing that, we have our first user which can already start creating your networking architecture. Now, going back, we have the other option for the federated identity. Here's something very good to mention, that you'll not be able to assign a federated identity to a group that you created here. Okay, this is only for the local user, and we can refer to it as a local group. If we go on the federation tab and we choose our identity provider here, you're gonna see another tab with groups where we will need to create another group for the networking admins. Okay, but this will be on the IDCS part. Okay, so this group will be federated and we're gonna name it as such. Then it is again worth mentioning that we cannot attach a policy directly to an IDCS group. In order to, let's say, bind them together, we're gonna need to create a group mapping. And the group mapping, it is exactly what the name suggests. It maps the local group with the federated group, with the IDCS group. So we're gonna search here for our network admins that we just created earlier in the federation tab. And we're gonna also search on the other part on the OCI group. We're gonna search for the network admins. This is the first group created and the group that contains the policies, the set of rules selected for it. We just click on add mappings and we'll be able to see it in the list here. After we did that, we just need to create the user. We give it a name, network admin, let's say IDCS, because this one is federated. Here we are now obliged to also add the email address, the first name and the last name. The phone number is optional. One of the great things by doing by choosing a federated identity is that you can select the network admins directly when you create the user. So you don't have to go on the user's page and add it manually. You can assign it directly, and you also can assign various other groups. The other two groups, the IDCS administrators, which give admin access over the federation services, and the OCI administrators, which will give access, admin access over the Oracle Cloud Infrastructure services. If you want to create like a second admin with the same privileges as yourself, I would recommend creating an IDCS user and adding the user to both of these groups, to IDCS and OCI administrators. And after you've done all this, you just click on create, and voila, you just managed to give access to your first federated user in order to start creating your networking architecture.